Thank you. It is hot in here. You can be seated. I know why I'm wearing a hazmat suit. Why are you wearing pajamas?
They've been wearing pajamas and eating breakfast during this service for the last 12 weeks. It's my turn.
I know what his real pajamas look like, and he's been to the store. We are so glad that you are here. You know, I had decided that I was just a crazy old retired preacher that they let get up and get dressed every morning and go to an empty office and sit in an empty room. And twice a week I'd come in here and preach to an empty room, and the folks were just too nice to tell me I was slap dab crazy. I am so glad to know I'm not crazy, that we actually still have a church and we're meeting again. It is so good to see you back. I woke up this morning like a kid at Christmas thinking, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, you know?
Amen.
I want to do a couple of things. One, I want you to join me in showing some appreciation, because for the last 3 months, I believe there have been 24 services, counting Sunday and Wednesday. The only reason you've been able to take part in a worship service from here, and we did all the services live, we didn't tape any of them, they were all live, and the Wednesday night Bible studies, the only reason you were able to do that was because of four people: Jesse and Keith and Suzanne and Matt. And I want you to thank them for what they've done. Now Matt is sitting right up there. He got all the glory for all four of them. He's usually on that camera for the last 3 months. And Jesse, Suzanne, and Keith are all in the back. But thanks to all of them. One other thing I want to do today. Are they in here?
Up in the corner up here.
Angela, would you stand for a minute? Where's Marcella? Marcella, would you stand for a minute? As of Friday, June the 5th, 2020, these two Brazilians became citizens of the United States of America. That is wonderful. Well, we're here ready to worship. We had a great service early.
We had a great service. Y'all have messed me up. You're not in your pew this morning. Y'all are supposed to be over here, and you're supposed to be back over here.
And you're supposed to have clothes on.
Yeah, well, you know, we love around our church to welcome each other. I mean, we're a touchy church. We like to shake hands, and it's hard not to shake hands this morning and to hug each other like we normally do. But we're going to do something this morning. I want you to look around the room, and I want you to look for somebody that you're glad to see this morning. You haven't seen them in 3 months, but you know them well. You know them by name. Look and find them right now. Look all around the room. Look all around the room. Now, here's what we're going to do.
They're already doing it.
When I say three, you're going to just yell to them, good morning, Suzanne, all right? One, two, three. There, we all get to welcome each other this morning.
Yeah. All right.
There we go.
He took you at heart.
Well, you know, this morning while we're in here, there are two other services right now. There's a group that's in the chapel that are worshiping. There's a group that is in the Wilson Hall that is worshiping. And there's another group that's online that's worshiping. So I want you, because the camera is all going in here right now to all of these groups. Here's a camera here, here's one here, here's one here. I want you to turn toward the camera and wave at the people that are in the other places this morning. And we're welcoming each other. We welcome you in Wilson Hall. We welcome you in the chapel this morning.
We wanted this to be a worshipful day, you know, just a day of celebration that we're back. Now, I want you to pay attention over the next few weeks, because what we've done today is to have 9 services as spread out as we could make them, and we're going to see where people are going. It's like building a campus and deciding where to put the sidewalks. We could try to lay the sidewalks and make you walk where we think they ought to go, or we could see where people are walking, where the natural path is, and put the sidewalks there. So we've just thrown a large, broad net today, and we're going to see where people are going. And then we're going to start tweaking the schedule and adjusting it and fitting the schedule of the people and what's needed and what's not needed. So pay attention to the eConnect and those kinds of things over the next several weeks, and we'll let you know as the schedule is changing from here to there. For example, I see some people seated here right now that told me that they were going to go to the safe service, but they're in this service. So obviously they're feeling more safe already. And as we go, I hope we feel safe soon, and we get back to normal. Well, I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer. Any other word I pray? Because I want to go get out of this hot suit. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the privilege of being in church. Until something's taken away, it's easy to take it for granted. We can go if we want to go. It's there. These last 3 months, if it's reminded me of anything, it is that we need each other. We are social people, and we are a part of the family of God, and we need each other, and it is good to be back. Lord, thank you for the privilege of being here. Help us not to ever take it for granted again. And I pray that everything we do today will, number one, lift the name of Jesus, and number two, put a smile on your face as your people in your house lift your praises toward heaven. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's sing it together.
Praise Father, who are blessings.
Remain standing. We're going to pray together this morning. After the prayer, we're going to continue to sing in worship this morning. But as we bow our heads now in prayer, let's ask God to prepare our hearts for what He wants to say to us today. You know, there's a lot of things going on in the world today that keeps our minds swirling. Let's ask the Lord these next few minutes just to allow us to set all that aside. Perhaps there are things in your personal life that for the next little bit, we're just going to rest in Jesus this morning. Allow Him to speak to us. Pray for our pastor as he shares and opens the Word this morning. Would you ask the Lord to let that Word be directly to you this morning? Not worry about anybody else, but just to you. Our Father, this morning, we praise You. We bless Your name. We glorify Your name. Father, thank You for giving us this day to gather again. It's the body of Christ known as First Baptist Hendersonville, the family of faith here. Lord, we thank You that we get to praise You through our singing. And Lord, we do lift up our voices to You and to You alone. Lord, You're our audience today. Father, we worship You through our giving. We thank You for the faithfulness of our church over these weeks and months that we've been able to bless many, many other people. Thank You, Father. But this morning, we worship You through listening to Your Word being proclaimed this morning. We thank You for our pastor. We pray that You'll bless him. Give him a holy anointing of Your Holy Spirit. Fill him. But Lord, prepare our hearts this morning. Speak directly to us. May we experience You this morning in this place. Through Christ Jesus, I pray. Amen. Let's continue to sing.
I have a God and I serve a God who could do anything. He's able to do anything that we can imagine. Let's sing this together.
Come ye sinners, poor and needy, come ye wounded, weak and worn. There's a harbor for the broken, where the homeless are reborn. Come ye lost, afraid, forgotten, let your wandering souls find rest. At your heart's door, He is knocking, for you His precious blood was shed.
He is able.
He is able. He is able. Christ is able still to save. Come, ye sinners, poor and needy, sing to Him our song of praise.
Is He able today? Can you feel Him? Sing it.
Come, ye ransomed and forgiven. Come, ye ransomed.
Let's speak.
Song goes on and on.
all of this, I think we just need to say thank you, Lord. We've been through a lot, but He's been faithful. Sing it with me.
Thank you.
That's right.
Thank you.
Tell the Lord today. Are you grateful for a loving Lord today? Tell Him thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, yes, Lord, thank you.
Crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on Him, and by His wounds we are healed.
Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is His body, and since we have the great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings.
Therefore, He is able to save completely those who come to God through Him, because He always lives to intercede for them.
Thank you, congregation. You may be seated.
Thank you.
has been wonderful to be back in God's house together again. I am so glad that we have moved to this point where we can start meeting in person. Here in the worship center, we've heard from the choir and orchestra today, though it's been a different setup. It's been wonderful to be able to do that. Thank you so much for those of you that have come to the worship service down in the chapel. We're calling that the safe room. I hope you felt safe and that you saw the organization and the intentionality that we've put into place, and you can tell other people that it is a safe place to go. Invite people to come. Tell them they'll be safe, and everyone around them will help them be that way in the weeks to come. Invite someone to come back next Sunday with you. And to those of you down in Wilson Hall, I hope it's been a wonderful worship experience there. I know it's a little bit different, but under the circumstances, I trust that it's been a great experience. I want to welcome those of you that are watching today on the internet, whether you're watching on our church webpage or Facebook Live. We're so glad that you've tuned in today. We are going to have a virtual campus going forward, and even after all of this is done and over, we're going to continue to seek to reach out to those virtually who cannot be here with us. They may live somewhere else. They may be sick or on vacation or whatever the case might be. We see a great opportunity in that virtual campus that we've kind of discovered during this time of the pandemic. So thank you for joining us today. It has been a great and a wonderful day. And thank you for being back and being a part of this. Well, today we're in the book of Hebrews. So if you'll take your Bible, we're going to be reading in a moment from the third chapter. I've called this whole series Living by Faith. And I really took that from the 11th chapter, where it keeps talking about those men and women of the Old Testament, and by faith, by faith, by faith. And so living by faith became the theme that I wanted to use to look at this book. But another great title for the whole book would be Jesus is Better, because that's the thing that the writer of Hebrews keeps saying to this Hebrew audience. Remember, these are people who have come out of Judaism. They came to understand that Jesus is the Messiah, and they were drawn to that. But over time, they're getting pressure. You can imagine that. They're getting pressure from family. They're getting pressure from members of their synagogue. They're getting pressure from neighbors. Why did you leave our faith? Why did you leave Judaism? Why have you followed this new teaching of Jesus? Why have you done that? And they're being compelled to return to it. And some of them are wavering a little bit. So the writer of Hebrews is encouraging them. And what he does, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is brilliant. He keeps going back into their past and showing them again what drew them to Christ in the first place. He's already said Jesus is better. Chapter 1, he said Jesus is better than the ancient fathers. He said Jesus is better than the prophets. He said Jesus is better than the angels. And in the passage we're about to read, he is going to say Jesus is better than Moses. Wow, what a strong word to say to a Jewish audience. Now, verse 1 of chapter 3 starts with the word therefore. That tells us that this chapter breaks a thought. You know, all of the Bible is inspired. Every word is inspired of God. But the chapter and verse divisions are not inspired. Those came hundreds of years later and simply were added for our convenience in being able to find a passage. And sometimes the chapter break comes in maybe an inopportune place. It comes in the middle of a thought, such as the case here. When the chapter starts with the word therefore, you know that it is the culmination of the thought that has just been said. So there is a clear tie between chapter 2 and chapter 3. So let's pick it up. Let's start reading in verse 1 of chapter 3. And this morning we're going to look at 6 verses as we consider this idea that Jesus is better than Moses. Let's read it. Therefore, holy brothers and companions in a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. He was faithful to the one who appointed him, just as Moses was in all God's household. For Jesus is considered worthy of more glory than Moses, just as the builder has more honor than the house. Now, every house is built by someone, but the one who built everything is God. Moses was faithful as a servant in all God's household as a testimony to what would be said in the future. But Christ was faithful as a son over his household. And we are that household if we hold on to the courage and the confidence of our hope.
Now, there are three things that I want you to notice this morning as we study through this passage. The first is that there's a comparison that the writer makes between Jesus and Moses. Now, Moses was a big deal to these Hebrew people. He was their superhero. He was at the apex of everything they had learned and believed all their lives. Now, Abraham, the father of the Hebrew people, was so important. Abraham's where it all began. It was out of Abraham that God raised up a nation. Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, those are all important people throughout the lineage and the history of the Hebrew people. But Moses was their hero. You remember Moses. Moses was born to a Hebrew slave, but was adopted into the household of Pharaoh. Moses pulled out of those bulrushes as a little baby. Moses, who was the one who saw the burning bush where God said, "Take off your sandals, you're standing on holy ground." And God gave him that directive that he was to go and lead his people out of Egypt, out of slavery, and to the promised land. It was Moses who handled the plagues. It was Moses who said to Pharaoh, "Let my people go." It was Moses who got the Ten Commandments from God. It was Moses who wrote the first five books of the Old Testament. It was Moses who led his people across the Red Sea. It was Moses who led them for 40 years in the wilderness. It was Moses who led them all the way to the Jordan River as they would then follow Joshua and cross over into the Promised Land. Moses was the man. And the writer of Hebrews begins this by just reminding the people, by going back into their heritage. It's brilliant what he does. He goes back into that one thing that they'd learned all their lives about this man who was the hero of their faith, and he compared Moses to Jesus. He compares them. Look at what he says there. Verse 2, he was faithful, talking about Jesus. Jesus was faithful to the one who appointed him, just as Moses was in all God's household. Moses was faithful, and Jesus was faithful. He's going to say down in verse 5, Moses was faithful as a servant of all God's household. He's going to say in verse 6, Christ was faithful as a son over God's household. So he compares Moses and Jesus. He sets them both out there to get the attention of this Hebrew audience. So there's a comparison. But then he moves to a contrast. And this is very important because he shows the difference. And he's basically saying to them, now remember the very thing that drew you to follow Jesus to begin with. You need to remember that and keep that in your mind. And as wonderful as Moses was, Jesus was better. As incredible as Moses was, Jesus was better. Now Moses was faithful, but remember the pattern of Moses' life. Moses spent the first 40 years of his life, if you remember, Moses was born to a Hebrew slave. And Pharaoh had decreed that all of the Hebrew boys would be put to death because Pharaoh was afraid that there were so many Hebrew boys being born that in a few years there would be so many of them that there would be an uprising and that there would be a revolt and that there would be so many Hebrew men that they would outnumber the Egyptian army and they would defeat them and overthrow Pharaoh's regime. And to keep that from happening, he was just going to have all the boys killed. Well, Moses' mother, when she had him, she did not allow them to know that he had been born, and so Moses was not put to death. And for 3 months, the Bible says, she hid him. But then he got big enough and loud enough that she could no longer hide him, and she took the basket. Remember that? And she lined the inside of the basket with pitch or tar to make it water tight. And she put the baby into the basket and hid him in some bulrushes in the river. As God would have it, in God's providence, the daughter of Pharaoh happened to come to the river at that very moment, in that very place. She came to take a bath, and she saw that basket and investigated and saw the baby and fell in love with him. And she adopted Moses. In one of the ironies of Scripture, Moses became a part of the household of Pharaoh. For 40 years, he lived in the lap of luxury in the palace of Pharaoh. And then one day, when he was about 40 years old, he saw a Hebrew that was being mistreated. It was being beaten by an Egyptian soldier. And something inside of Moses, something in that Hebrew blood began to boil inside of him, and he could not take it. And it just boiled over in anger, and he went and killed the Egyptian soldier, and he hid his body. Remember, he buried his body, and he thought no one would know. The next day he saw two Hebrews fighting, and he went to break up the fight. And one of them said, well, are you going to kill one of us like you killed the Egyptian yesterday? And he realized that the secret was out. And so he fled. He went to Midian, the wilderness. He spent the first 40 years of his life in the lap of luxury, living in the palace of Pharaoh. He spent the next 40 years in the wilderness. It was there that he met Zipporah, who would become his wife. It was there that he tended sheep for his father-in-law. It was there that he saw the burning bush, and God spoke to him. He said, you're standing on holy ground, and God called him to go back to Egypt and lead his people out of slavery and into freedom in the promised land. The last 40 years of Moses' life, he led his people across the Red Sea toward the promised land. They sinned against God in not being willing to totally trust him, and as a result they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years until that generation died off and another generation was born. You could summarize Moses' life this way. He lived 120 years. It was divided up into three sections of 40 years. He spent the first 40 years of his life living in a palace thinking he was somebody. He spent the next 40 years of his life on the backside of the desert in Midian, realizing that he was a nobody. He spent the last 40 years of his life leading God's people out of slavery and toward the promised land, coming to understand that God can make a somebody out of a nobody. You need to hear that today. No matter where you've been in your life, God can take a nobody and make a somebody out of them. So Moses was faithful for part of his life, but for part of his life he was not. So as good as Moses was, Jesus was better. Now, in this contrast, the writer uses two illustrations to make his point. He uses an illustration of a house, and this is what he basically says. I'm paraphrasing it, but this is what he says. No one would go into a house and say, what a beautiful house this is. I wish a house would create itself like this for me. I wonder how this house built itself so beautifully. No one would go into a house and praise the house for being such a beautiful house. You see a beautiful house and you praise the architect or the builder that actually constructed it. You want to know who built this house. Who is the constructor of this house so that I can go to them and get them to build a house for me. Now, the contrast that he's making here is that Moses is the house. And as beautiful as the house is, it's the house that someone else created. Moses is the house. And Moses should receive glory, but the one who built the house should receive more glory. The one who created the house gets more glory and more honor. So while Moses is good, Jesus is better because Jesus is the builder of the house. Moses is just the house. The second illustration that he uses is that of Moses was a slave or a servant. That's what he says there in verse 5, that Moses was faithful as a servant in all of God's household. But Christ, verse 6, Christ was faithful as a slave. Christ was faithful as a son. Moses was faithful as a slave. Christ was faithful as a son. So they're two different things. And Jesus is better. Now that's the obvious teaching of what this passage is saying. He is calling these Hebrew Christians, these Jews who have come out of Judaism to follow Jesus, he is calling them to remember why they followed Jesus to begin with. And that is because they had come to understand that Jesus is, in fact, better. So there is the comparison. Moses and Jesus were faithful. There is the contrast. Even though they were both faithful, Jesus was more faithful, and Jesus is more deserving of glory. As a matter of fact, he says in verse 5, look at the end of verse 5, he says that what Moses did was a testimony to what God would be said in the future. So Moses, all that Moses did was a foreshadowing of what God was going to one day do through his son. What Moses exemplified was to point to what Jesus would come to do. So as important as Moses was to these Hebrew people, Jesus must be even more important. So there's the comparison and the contrast. Now the third thing I want you to focus on this morning is the challenge. The challenge becomes the so what of this passage. I tell you a lot of times that when you read a passage of Scripture, you hear a sermon, you listen to a Sunday school class, you always should come to the end and say, so what? I've just had a good Bible study. I learned some information about this person or that person or this event. But so what? How does that affect my life? How does that impact the way that I'm supposed to live? So let's look at the so what. It's in verse 1 and it's in verse 6. Now the first part of the so what is that we need to remember who we are. We need to remember who we are. Look at what he says. Verse 1. Therefore, holy brothers and companions in a heavenly calling. We are holy brothers. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. He's going to say in verse 6 that we are God's household. We need each other. I'm so glad that we're back together today as we're studying this passage. Remember what the writer of this book is going to say in chapter 10, verse 25, when he says, do not forget to gather together as God's people. Do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together. It is so important. We need each other. Families need each other. We cry on each other's shoulders. We weep with each other. We rejoice with each other. We encourage each other. We hold each other accountable. We do not live in isolation or in a bubble. We live with each other and we need each other. He reminds us that we are a part of God's family. It's a wonderful reminder of who we are. We are holy brothers and companions in a heavenly calling. God has called us to follow Him. God has called us to follow Him. Now, one element of God's calling is in salvation, and certainly that is true. And we cannot just wake up one morning and decide, hey, I think this is the day that I'm going to turn my life around and be saved. We don't have the ability to turn our life around and be saved. God has to do that for us. So He has to call us. He has to convict us of our sin, and no one can be saved unless the Holy Spirit does that. There is that element of calling in regard to salvation, but there is also an element of calling in the living out of our life, being who God wants us to be. He refers to this heavenly calling, living out your faith. You ever been waiting on a call? Maybe you interviewed for a job and you're expecting to hear something and you're waiting for the phone to ring. Maybe you had a date and it went well and you're hoping the person will call again. Maybe you had some medical test and they told you they would call with the results and you're just kind of sitting by the phone and waiting and your thoughts are, why don't they call? When are they going to call? I can't wait for them to call. Well, he said he's given us a heavenly calling. That God has called us not only to salvation, he has called us to that, but he has called us to live out our faith. That's who we are. Remember who you are. Now there's a statement down in verse 6. He reminds us that we are God's household. We are God's family. We need each other. We need him to be the head of the household. But look at what he says in that last sentence there in verse 6. We are that household if we hold on to the courage and the confidence of our hope. Now some people believe that that verse means that we have to hold on to our with courage and confidence, we have to hold on in order to stay saved. And if we lose our grip, we could be lost, like a person holding on to the side of a ledge that's fallen over a cliff and they're holding on with their fingers and their hands are growing weak. And if they lose their grip, they will lose their life because they'll fall. There are some people that believe that this verse means that you could lose your grip on your salvation and you could be lost. I don't believe that at all. I believe that when a person truly comes to repentance, they've been born again, they've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. You take all of the pictures that the Bible uses to talk about our salvation. We are adopted into His family. We are made new creation in Christ. We are born again. When you talk about all of those things, I don't think it's possible for a person who has truly been born again and saved to ever be lost. Now, we can lose our fellowship with God. We can sin against God and walk out of His fellowship. The Bible even uses a word to describe that. It's called backsliding. It doesn't mean we've lost our salvation. Now, somebody says, well, I knew a person, and they used to go to church, and they taught Sunday school. They were a deacon. They sang in the choir. They may have even been the preacher. And now they say they don't even believe in God. What about that? Well, here's what I say about that. If they're not saved right now, they never were saved. If they're not saved right now, they never were saved. And if they were saved, they still are saved. Now, they may be out of fellowship with God, and they may be breaking God's heart, and they may not be living a life, and they will pay consequences. There will be consequences for living life that way, but we don't lose our salvation. That's not what he's talking about. I think all he's saying in this passage is that as we live out our faith, that is evidence. That is proof, if you will, that we are walking with God and we are His household. We're not saved because we do those things. We do those things because we've been saved. Now, a couple of years ago, we studied through the book of Galatians, and Paul wrote about this matter. He was writing to a church that had Jews and Gentiles in the church, and the Jews were saying to the Gentiles, before you can be a Christian, you've got to become a Jew. So you've got to keep the Jewish customs and eat the Jewish food and follow all the Jewish laws. And this is what Paul wrote. Christ has liberated us to be free. By the way, this is Galatians chapter 5, verses 1 through 4. Christ has liberated us to be free. Stand firm then, and don't submit again to a yoke of slavery. Take note, I, Paul, tell you that if you get yourself circumcised, Christ will not benefit you at all. Again, I testify to every man who gets himself circumcised that he is obligated to keep the entire law. You who are trying to be justified by the law are alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. Now, that doesn't mean that we've lost salvation. That just means we're not trusting in the grace that God offers. We're trusting in what we can do. We're trusting in our ability to keep the law and to do this and don't do that. It's going back to legalism. And Paul was telling the Galatians, don't do that. Don't walk away from grace. Well, that's the same idea that the writer of Hebrews says. That as we live out our faith, we are demonstrating and proving that we are the household of God. So remember who you are. We are the family of God, and we have a heavenly calling. But here's the most important thing. It's the last thing. Remember who He is. Remember who He is. That's the so what of this passage. Remember who He is. Look at verse 1 again. Therefore, holy brothers and companions in a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. I love that phrase, consider Jesus. I don't think the word consider is as strong in English as it is in the original language. Sometimes we consider something and it's just a fleeting thought. We really don't give much attention to it. You know, you finish a meal in a restaurant, a waiter walks over and hands you a dessert menu and says, would you consider the bread pudding? Well, you may take the menu and glance at it. You may give a passing look at what the menu says, but you've already decided. You're already full. You're already gathering up your things, and you're ready for the ticket. You're getting ready to go. You take a casual glance at the menu, but you quickly hand it back without any thought and say, no, we're done. You really didn't consider it. You just glanced at it. Now, that's the word sometimes that comes out, consider, for us. But this is a stronger word than that. This means to give careful consideration. This means to really think about Jesus. This means to fix your focus on Jesus. One translation even says, give a long, hard look at Jesus. Consider Jesus. Think about Jesus. Focus on Jesus. And look at what he says about him. This is who he is. The apostle and high priest of our confession. Now, why in the world, under the inspiration of God, did the writer of Hebrews use those two words? The apostle and high priest of our confession. There's a very important reason. And the Hebrew people to whom the writer wrote this heard it the moment he said it. He is our apostle. Jesus is our apostle. And the word apostle means to be sent. How many times does the New Testament talk about Jesus being sent by God, a man sent from God? We sing, God sent his son. That's what the New Testament says. God sent Jesus. Another word that you could use for this idea of being the apostle, you could use the word ambassador. An ambassador is sent from one nation to another nation. He represents that nation. Jesus was sent by God. He is God's ambassador who came to represent God to us. We could not know God if God had not sent Jesus to us. He was sent. But the high priest, that's the opposite. The apostle is sent by God to represent God to us. The high priest goes from us to God to represent us to God. The high priest goes to God to say their sin has been atoned for. The price for their sin has been paid. They have been washed and been made clean. The sacrifice, the offering has been acceptable. The apostle is sent from God to represent God to us. The high priest goes from us to God to say to God that our sin has been atoned for. That's who Jesus is. He is our apostle, and he is our high priest. I don't know anything about transcendental meditation, but I've been told that what that means is that you get in some kind of bodily position, and you get in a very quiet situation, and you just try to empty your mind of all thoughts. Just empty your mind. I don't know that I would be able to do that. The Bible actually says the opposite. You don't empty your mind. You fix your mind on Jesus. You give a long, hard look. You concentrate. You fill your thoughts with Jesus. And when you do, when you consider Jesus, when you take a long, hard look at Jesus, who is our apostle sent by God to tell us that he loves us, our high priest who goes in our stead to say to holy God that our sin has been atoned for, when you fill your mind with Jesus, it will change everything. So turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. If you would like to talk with someone about what it means to walk with Jesus, whether that means to come to know him as your Savior because you've never really trusted him as the Lord of your life, or whether you're already a Christian but you really want to go deeper in your walk with him, you truly want to fix your eyes on Jesus, we want to help you with that. Right now, if you just take your phone wherever you are, in the chapel, down in Wilson Hall, wherever you are around the world watching this worship service, if you would just take your phone and text to the number 99000, 99000, if you would just text the word START, S-T-A-R-T, someone from our ministry team here in Hendersonville will call you and talk with you about how you can either come to know the Lord as your Savior or how you can go deeper in your faith as you fix your eyes on Jesus. Let me lead us in a word of prayer. Bruce is going to come and share just another word or two before we finish today. Father, thank you for this wonderful word. You are sent by God to bring us a message of love. And you represent us to God as our high priest because you paid the price for our sin. And so today we fix our eyes on Jesus because he is the Lord of lords and King of kings. Thank you for this day. Thank you for the wonderful joy of being back together in God's house. In Jesus' name, amen. Bruce?
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. What an incredible message this morning. What a great time we've had this morning in worship. It's been so good to regather again, to be together again. It's been a little bit different, and it'll continue to be so for a while, but the presence of the Lord has made himself known this morning. You may have noticed during the course of the service that we didn't take an offering like we normally do. We traditionally have a time in the service service where we pass offering plates and we give our offering. We believe that's a time and a part of our worship. But under the new protocol and guidelines, instead of passing the plate, there's opportunities to give your offering in receptacles and boxes, offering boxes that are located around the church facility. If you're watching online, I encourage you to go to our website. There you'll find a tab that simply says give. You can click on that. You can make a gift, and those gifts are used to take the gospel around the world, to provide the ministry right here locally as well. We look forward to seeing you and being together again next week. Remember, our Wednesday night will continue online with our pastor's Revelation Bible study. We'll not have in-person gatherings for a few more weeks on our Wednesday nights. Have a wonderful, wonderful day. God bless you.